This is the so what, so what now question, and I am so pleased to be moderating and not be the one who has to come up with an answer. But we have the right people here to come up with an answer. I have asked them to share with them their reactions, just their gut reactions to what has happened in the last day and a half, what it is they take home. And in fact, what they have shown me, a couple of them, I discovered they had printed out notes, which gave me some concern, because like, how can you have printed out notes if you're supposed to have listened for a day and a half and come up with your conclusions? But they proved to me that actually the back of the printed out notes are totally full of new commentary. So I actually can't wait to hear what you, the people who we have on the panel are folks who have pretty major responsibilities at George Mason. We have, of course, you have their names and titles, but they're in charge of just managing the academic infrastructure of Mason, but also driving innovation for the future. And anyway, I'm very curious. Peter, why don't we start with you?
Okay. Well, let me begin first, not exactly responding to the main charge.
I'm used to that, so it's all right.
No. I'm going to be obedient for the most part. I think I would like to echo something you said earlier, and that is a very great thank you to my fellow panelists who put so much of this together, to events management and several other people who orchestrated the logistics of the arrangement, but above all, to those of you who attended. Frankly, I was very pleasantly surprised by the number of people who staggered in today. It's not an inconsiderable investment, and I think you should be proud, as I am, to be part of a university where there is this level of interest in issues of concern to George Mason. So thank you. I took away, I think, three principal things where I hope we can take what we've learned and also engage in further discussion. One constraint, obviously, is despite all of the topics raised during these 2 days, we did not talk about everything. We did not talk much about global, and we did not talk much about research. So ultimately, the conversation will have to become even more complicated, and we should recognize that, and that'll impinge on what I say. But that said, three major things. One was a theme that I thought we started out with fairly clearly yesterday. I don't think it's been lost, but we didn't end up focusing on it as much recently. And that is one thing that's an increasingly important opportunity for an institution like George Mason is to be increasingly explicit and public about things we actually already do pretty well. We heard yesterday about the importance of reasonably conventional higher ed operations in promoting student maturity, in promoting student-faculty contact. These are areas where we've actually worked fairly self-consciously over the past few years. In some cases, as with student-faculty contact, there are areas in which we've made some measurable improvements, but we need to keep working on them, but also to highlight them so that it does not seem like we're entirely needing to reinvent the wheel. So that's category number one. Let's be clear to ourselves and obviously to potential applicants where we're already pretty strong and self-conscious about that strength. Two, and this is the big umbrella category, we obviously have all sorts of opportunities and frankly needs toward further innovation and experiment. And I do want to heighten the word experiment. I think we should be launching a number of kinds of endeavors, not necessarily as full commitments for the university for the next 5 years, but as things we want to look at. Obviously, we heard this morning a tremendous number of opportunities to do better in dealing with underclass educational experiences. And we certainly want to encourage further innovation in the structure and content and student success in the lower level courses, including commodity courses. And President Ochoa also mentioned some very interesting freshman year ideas. So we want to innovate in that category. We also, I think, will increasingly need to innovate in the kinds of credentials we accept from students who are transferring here. That will include greater acknowledgement of competency measures that have been developed elsewhere. We're actually surprisingly rigid on that score now, and I think we have to re-examine that. We probably need to take a look at the results of self-paced activities that we don't necessarily now take into account for. So that's another area where additional flexibility is required. One theme that Anya mentioned yesterday that I really want to pick up on, because most of our focus has inevitably been on the undergraduate experience and particularly the freshman-sophomore experience, I think we're in for some considerable challenges in master's-level education as additional training options and certificate recognitions come to pass. So I hope we will innovate in the way we promote, the way we deliver master's programs towards sometimes greater flexibility, greater willingness to collaborate with other modes of delivery. I think this is going to be an interesting challenge for us, and we may be seeing the first wave of that challenge already, and I wouldn't neglect this in the interest of focus on undergraduates. And finally, obviously, there's the challenge of experimenting with methods of delivery that at least preserve existing levels of student success, ideally enhance them, while saving money. I think on the whole, the panels have been a little more engaged in the excitement of new technology and new outcomes and new kinds of classrooms, some of which actually end up costing more money rather than less. I was very glad that President Ochoa, in the last talk, brought us back to the reality of needing to face the cost and access pressure, because I don't think there are easy ways to deal with that other than by some really focused educational experiments. And we need to be talking about that too. And as President Ochoa implied, this is going to sometimes be very challenging and painful for faculty. The third thing I take away is something that I think we need. I think we have a good framework for discussing this at Mason, but I think we need to be quite explicit about it. We need to pay attention to the relationship between the challenges that face us, the challenges and opportunities that face us that have been discussed over the past couple of days, the relationship between these and faculty rewards and incentives. I think we will need to engage a willingness to recognize faculty contributions in teaching innovations even more strongly than we already do. I do say this recognizing that we all also want to move forward with research. In some cases, we can look to individual faculty to contribute in both research and teaching and innovation domains. But I think we're probably going to want to identify and reward an increasing number of people on grounds of teaching innovation primarily. And this is going to be hard for us. It's going to be challenging for us. But speaking totally personally and not as a policy matter, I think we need to engage this. Because if we don't do this, we're just loading stuff on faculty in ways to which they cannot sensibly or creatively respond. And it's the creative response that we really want to be encouraging. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Peter. Jeanette, your thoughts.
Thank you. True confession, I have a piece of paper here that I actually have a few notes on, with lots of scribble, because there was so much that we were exposed to yesterday, lots of interesting ideas, and I thought I needed to put a few down. I want to start, though, by confessing that I think I've become a Twitter convert, and this has taken some painful moments for me, in that I started a Twitter account only because I heard our new president was into that, and I thought, all right, I'm going to just check it out. And I'm one who likes technology. I've always embraced new kinds of technology in my classroom. But it's been interesting to see this kind of conversation that's happening in cyberspace as we are sitting in these meetings. And it's kind of showing me about even my own students when I say, okay, no laptops or keep your technology at the door, you know, that there are ways, there are really important ways that we can use technology. But the thing we have to keep in mind is that these are all tools, right? We need to think about what is the best way to teach in terms of the kinds of learning outcomes we want for our students. There are some wonderful lecturers here, and I would hate to see those kinds of formats disappear. Yet we know that we need to embrace some of these new challenges as well. I think we have to be careful, though, assuming that just because these are new technologies that students are interested in them. I see students who are really tired of having to blog in all of their classes. I see students that have no real interest in Twitter. And so how do we deal with those kinds of students who are learning in different ways? And the thing to keep in mind is, what tools do we need to use to best help our students learn? What's going to be really important? But the thing I also wanted to pull out that I learned from watching the Twitter feeds and also listening to all of our panelists are the tensions that we have, and I think there's several here. Provost Stearns talked about the faculty rewards. This is huge. We have to think about new ways to really honor innovation. There are many who have been trying to do innovative work on campus for a very long time, and it's hard to do that in a climate that does value so greatly in importance of research and fundraising, grants, and so forth. So we have to think about, how do we really honor this kind of work as well? It's hard to do innovative work. It takes a huge amount of time for faculty, and we have to always keep that in mind. Another tension is that we know we need to collaborate more. I think this morning, Suzanne Walsh talking about data and the need to work together and take advantage of a number of different skills that people have in creating the picture that that data represents. We need to collaborate, yet we're so siloed. And why is that? Why are we in these groups? Well, partly it's because we're really, really busy, right? You know, for many people, it's all that we can do to teach the courses and to do the research and to do the service. And so now you're asking me to talk to my neighbors. Well, how do I do that? And I think that we as an institution have to find ways to really support and encourage that collaboration. And then I think that we have to another tension is that we want more interdisciplinary learning. That seems to be an important direction that we need to go in. And yet, it's really difficult to do that kind of work and to value that, because we have so many requirements within departments to be the good departmental citizen, that to be able to go out and really engage with other faculty members around the university in an interdisciplinary setting is a very difficult challenge for a lot of faculty. So I love the kinds of ideas that we've been exposed to in these 2 days, but I think that there's some real tensions that we have to face as an institution. We know we need to do things some things differently. We need to move forward in an exciting, dynamic way, but we also have to keep in mind, how do we honor the work that our faculty and staff do? And how do we create these collaborations, more collaboration with university life? We haven't really talked much about university life. Student affairs side is such a critical part of what we do here at this institution. We need to find better ways to work together and to really honor all the various ways that students can learn, whether it's through the classroom setting, experiential learning, or in cyberspace on Twitter. I think we can all learn and grow from this. The challenge is, where do we go from here, and how do we keep these conversations going?
Thank you. Sharon.
So last Sunday night, I went to a play in the Center for the Arts called Into the Woods. And for 7 days, there has been this relentless song that will not leave my head. If there are any CVPA faculty members here, they just want to stand up and sing this Into the Woods title song.
Come on, Rick. Rick can do it. You know he can.
Out of the woods and home before we
That has been going through my head for 7 days. So it's, you know, this is the song that's rolling through my head as I'm going to bed last night, trying to sleep, you know, kind of wound up in the day thinking about today as well. And all I can think about is, for the past 2 days, we've been in the woods. We've gone on this journey, and we've been searching for our higher education happily ever after. And I'm thinking, from that, I'm wanting to learn what is it that we wish. And we need to be really thoughtful about that as an institution. And before we go into the journey into the woods again, let's think about what it is that we want as a community. How do we work together to achieve that we wish? So someone help me get the song out of my head. So that was one thing that I was thinking of, because I just can't get that song out, sorry. To speak a little bit to Peter's point, there were definitely some things that we did not talk about over the course of the last 2 days, or touched on so lightly, and I think they'll have to be a part of the conversation. We really have not decided some key things that we want to do as an institution, and one of the pieces that I would like to talk about more is openness. How open do we want to be? How open should our content be? How open should our technology be? Does that constrain us? Does that help us? So for me, that's an essential part of the ongoing conversation. And lastly, and briefly, we've talked a lot about redesign or re-engineering. And really, I have to say, you know, one of the things that drew me to George Mason is, you know, we're innovative. There are just some amazing capabilities here in the people, in the technologies, in the spaces that we have, in the spirit that we have as an institution. And we have already done a lot of work in this arena. I was just as disturbed by President Ochoa as the either-or of efficiency versus effectiveness. And I would say we've done a lot of marrying that already. So we have some incredibly hard work to do as an institution, because I think in many ways we've captured a lot of the low-hanging fruit. Now, granted, there are plenty of context and technology changes and other ways that we can think of doing things, but we're going to have to work together to figure out how we get to this next and more difficult step. So I'll go back to that. As we go into the woods again, how do we do it together? How do we do it in a way that brings us to the next step? And, you know, I think about this, and I think I always say this whenever I have a conversation with faculty or we do workshops or whatever. This isn't the only time that we have the conversation. This is a moment in time. How do we continue the journey?
Thank you so much. Kim, what are you going to sing?
I don't know. You know, I think in part of continuing the conversation, a couple of things. I think that I'm a member, as are some other folks in this room, of one of President Cabrera's working groups. And I think you all know that we're in the strategic visioning process right now. And the working group that I have the privilege of being on is the one that's about Mason's mission and core values and what we want our graduates to look like. What do we want them? Who do we want them to be? And what can we sort of claim from somebody who's left our institution? And I think that you all are really important members of feeding myself. Rose Pasquarel's on that committee, Nance Lucas is on that committee, Pam Patterson's on that committee, feeding us information about that, particularly in light of having participated in the past day and a half, because I think there's been a lot of food for thought that will inform that conversation. So this is just an open invitation to please email myself about your thoughts around those kinds of issues, and I'm happy to sit down and have a conversation with you about that. One of the panelists yesterday was talking about transformational learning, and the two things in the interviews with students that seemed to really impact their learning in a transformational way, and one of them had to do with the personal failures. And I guess I want to take that to the institutional level, and I want to think about how we can embrace institutional failures and the fact that we learn from institutional failures. Because if we're going to have a Center for Innovation in Teaching or Faculty Innovation or Excellence in Innovation or however that ends up working out, or if it ends up being just an initiative or whatever, we're not going to get it right the first time, or frankly, we probably haven't taken a big enough risk. And so I think one of the things that we really want to be thinking about is how do we as an institution, as a culture, start thinking about learning from those examples, making transparent the individual failures that I might have in my classroom and share them with somebody else so that we can have that community knowledge about what's working and what's not working. And then also, similarly, and this goes back to the fact that a couple of times we've talked about, you know, Peter, you mentioned needing to share our successes more. We do have successes that we are not doing a good enough job on, and I'll claim it because this is probably something that I should be doing more of sharing the successes of faculty across this institution. Successes of faculty members who've participated for the past several years as part of the Curriculum Innovation Group in the College of Science. Successes of our Teaching Excellence Award winners and our Teachers of Distinction who are doing phenomenal work in their classroom. So we know that this kind of innovation is happening. Our Distance Education Award winners, we acknowledge them, we recognize them, we try to have them present to the community at our Innovations in Teaching and Learning Conference, but I think we need to step it up and think about ways to create digital modules or other sort of introductions to these folks about the kinds of work that's happening and build that kind of community knowledge. Similar to that, I think that the failures have to be built into our culture in a way that faculty don't get penalized for taking those chances and taking those risks. I think, you know, I do think that our faculty reward structure needs to be rethought, and it probably shouldn't be the teaching service research trifecta anymore. Maybe it's time to be rethinking that. Maybe it's Boyer. It doesn't have to be Boyer, though. Professional development, it strikes me, has been a thread throughout this entire conversation, and maybe we need to be thinking about a category around professional development. So as long as you're telling me what you're doing in terms of your teaching, tell me what you're doing in terms of your research or scholarship, if that's part of your portfolio, tell me what you're doing in terms of commitment to the institution, but also what are you doing in terms of professional development? How is that impacting your scholarship? How is it impacting your teaching? How are you sharing back to the Mason community and helping others with their professional development? So I think that we really need to be a lot more thoughtful and creative. And I think that, you know, somebody, I think it was the person from Western Governors who sat up here and said that we can't afford the model where all faculty are good at everything anymore. I actually don't know if that's true. Maybe that is true. But I do think that we ought to capitalize on people's strengths, and maybe that means giving faculty members more voice on how they spend and allocate their time, and then having them be evaluated on the basis of what those impacts were. You know, if I want to spend 50% of my time in innovation over the next 3 years, maybe that's the way that we ought to think about evaluating my intentions and my contribution to the institution. So, I mean, I think that there's a lot of things to think about in terms of those particular pieces. You know, the other thing about the transformational learning that the person's talked about and that Ken mentioned in his talk around deep learning really is the questions and the inquiry-based piece and the connection to faculty members. And one of the conversations that we had yesterday was about, and I know a lot of the folks in this room, so I know that we span the continuum and how much we believe in this, but that content has to precede inquiry-based learning. And I think we've seen a lot of evidence and had a lot of conversation over the past couple of days that, in fact, inquiry-based learning can lead to enhanced content learning. And content learning is embedded in the inquiry and the critical thinking. They're not divorced. And so this option, you know, President Ochoa talked about it, of having the first-year students flipping the curriculum. You know, we're doing all this scaffolding of the curriculum around here's what we want to happen at the 100 level, and here's what we want to happen at the 200 level, and here's what we want to happen as they get here. And this whole notion of the student swirl and being at three or four institutions by the time that they get to us completely messes with our entire conceptualization of what it means to scaffold a curriculum for students. So I don't know what we're going to do about that, how we're going to find out what competency level that they're at around their knowledge, skills, and abilities that they need for any particular field of study. But I think that that's going to be a huge challenge for us, and it's a huge assessment challenge for us. And that's just going to bring me to, at least for now, my last point, which is that I'm really proud of the way that we think about assessment at George Mason University, and this is a huge testament to Karen Genneman's leadership and the leadership that she's provided in the Office of Institutional Assessment. But it's course-embedded, it's faculty-driven. We don't say that you need to take the standardized test over here and we're going to compare you to the other 20 institutions that are taking the standardized test. We say, you know what you want your students to learn. Think about the assignments and the learning activities that help them get there and show us the evidence that you're making progress. And we're one of the few institutions in the entire Southern Association of Colleges and Schools who pass without a single demerit recommendation, our SACS accreditation doing this. But it gives faculty a lot of ownership and authorship. And so I think that as we think about the bifurcation of faculty roles, people talked about unbundling faculty roles, I think we need to be careful about divorcing the assessment from the teaching and learning. Because one of the practices that we know about really enhancing teaching and learning is me checking in with my students and finding out, I thought I nailed this particular learning outcome with a particular activity or assignment that I built, and I got the assignment and it was crap, so what did I do wrong? And that has to influence my teaching cycle. And so taking the assessment out of that professional development, I think, is a problem, and I think we're gonna have to think about what that really means in terms of outsourcing certain things as we look towards efficiencies.
Thank you, Kim. Goodlett.
Thank you very much. So I really love my colleagues, and I did the assignment. And the assignment that I heard was... so what do you think now... How do you think differently than when you arrived at the conference? And even though I do have some notes, part of them are just from today. So the first thing I wanted to say was, you know, I thought when I got here that I was pretty smart. And then I realized that I have had a meeting with Kevin Clark. Anyway, that helps ground me a little bit in the rest of my comments. But the second thing I wanted to say is that I had a chance to meet a 19-year-old student on campus. And his story was that he was here because he was homeless. His family had basically abandoned him, and he was living on campus. And he had to work. He had to use all of the university services, not just one, because he didn't have a helicopter parent. He didn't have any other resources other than the resources that the Mason family provides. And before I got here, I thought Distance Ed is a failure at Mason because we grew 33%, but our enrollment didn't. And then I realized that, you know, University of Florida grew 60% in terms of students on campus who are taking at least one online course. Well, this particular student may be one of those students who took one or more online courses so he could live on campus and finish his degree. And the other piece of that is the whole socialization discussion isn't just about living on campus. It isn't just about living on campus and taking courses. Those two things can be separated completely. Not completely, but they can be separated. And we're in a kind of a new world with new kinds of adult learners, young learners, et cetera. So I thought that was kind of important. The second thing is that building a financial model is hard. For a public, it may be harder. You know, the FTE model is really fascinating. You know, I don't understand it at all. I came from healthcare, and Anya talked about healthcare. And, you know, in healthcare, when technology, when we got a new piece of equipment or we got a new joint commission regulation, we had to hire more administrators because we had to keep up with this stuff or we couldn't do business. It was basically like that. And I kind of see that parallel in higher ed. But the truth is, you know, this kind of profit center model isn't necessarily something that will break down silos. And I've heard silos mentioned over and over and over again. To me, it separates what Mason does really well, which is if we break down the silo walls when we need something. And people tend to rally around that. I don't know why. I mean, you're already too busy. I know that. But you've done that with me for SACS and for other SACS and for other reasons. And, you know, I'm really grateful for that. And I'm not so sure we can just recreate a model and make it work. UMUC, even ASU, thank you. But Penn State World Campus. One other piece about that is World Campus is losing money. Well, they're losing students. I don't know if they're losing money. So we may be able to copy, and we may be able to realize some real gains in that process short term. But that's not the long-term answer, and that's not what makes Mason unique. And I guess the other thing, there's a couple more. Jonathan Goldman's here, right? Jonathan, would you? Hi, Jonathan. I think everybody knows Jonathan. And he's the director of computational services or something like that in Volgeno. But he's been around here a long time. And, you know, I keep thinking that it's you know, attraction rather than promotion with distance ed students. I'm sorry, distance ed faculty. And by the way, this is very much like filming a DE clip if you're sitting here right now. It's like no interaction, and there's the camera. But it's not so much fun. So what Jonathan said to me is, you know, we're trying to ask these tenured faculty and distinguished people to stand up in front of a camera, give up their content, you know, be brilliant, and then commoditize that for the sake of reaching more people and increasing their workload and all that sort of thing. He said, what's the intrinsic reward for the faculty member? And when I got here today, I thought I had the answer to that. But what I realized from Dr. Offutt's presentation was that I don't have the answer at all. That came from a faculty member encouraging another faculty member to take a choice, take a chance, and to do something out of their comfort zone. And the faculty member ended up saying that he had a better experience with his doctoral students because of the technology that he added to his classroom. So the last thing I'll say is that, you know, ASU very much enjoyed their conversation. Western Governors very much enjoyed their conversation. We are not those organizations. And we have something special. The people here know that. I've got a list of people I've talked to here. You know, Sarah Nutter and Michelle, people that created an online executive MBA a dozen years ago and kept really good data about that. We've got Allison O'Brien building a minor in business that, you know, was hard to get to happen. You know, we've got Linda Monson, who taught online over a dozen years ago, you know, and in arts. I mean, it's amazing. We've got Tina Adams, some of the new people, Josh Eiler. Tina was the librarian at ASU, who's now our distance education librarian. She brings things to us that nobody else can bring. Fabulous, fabulous people. And there are a lot more. But I think I'll stop there.
Thank you, Goodland. I'll give you a chance to react to these four people, Peter, if you want. You don't have to.
Well, I think the main point that they're all emphasizing in different, well, the main points are one, we do have the opportunity because we have considerable existing strengths and we also have some distinctive challenges. We do have the opportunity to face to forge a Mason response to the challenges, and they're very real challenges of higher education in the 21st century. I mean, Goodlett sort of emphasized that at the end, but I think everybody has to some extent. And the other response, picking up on my colleagues as well, is we obviously want to find ways to maintain the conversation, to get wide input, but not only to converse, but begin to do further things toward experimentations with educational delivery, experimentations with different cost models, et cetera, even experimentations with different components of graduate education. One of the things that struck me yesterday is those of us educating PhD students who want to go into academic life, I sure think we need to put more teaching elements into that experience. It's not a new theme, but we haven't done it very well so far because I think increasingly, unless you're just an unbelievable star researcher, if you don't end up both liking and knowing how to teach pretty well, you probably shouldn't go into academic life at this point. So I think there are all sorts of things that we can converse about and actually move from conversation into action. And we can do all this if we could go back to into the woods before the wolf is actually at the door.
Before I open up for questions, I didn't want to fully hide behind the moderator role, and I do have some reactions I would also want to share. My first one is, I have been blown away by this last day and a half. And again, as I still, even though four and a half months into the job, 5 months already maybe, I still have maybe an outside's view into this community. This is fantastic. I mean, the fact that this community can get together, subject itself to this pressure of ideas from people doing all sorts of interesting things and have the conversations that we've had, I think it's absolutely fantastic. And a couple of thoughts that I heard yesterday, especially towards the end of the day, a few people mentioned to me, like, I feel like I just looked over the cliff. This is mind-boggling. It's just scary. I don't even know what it means for us. And I think as important as it is for a community like ours to look outside, to see what's going on, to be very realistic about the challenges we face, it is equally important to look inside and recognize all the great things that we already do as an organization and all the things that absolutely do not need to change. I've always thought that when you engage in a process of change, it is essential that you look and identify the things that you do not want to risk or change. And I think there are lots of those in this institution. This is an amazing community of educators, of researchers, of scholars, of artists, of scientists. We educate 33,000 students every year. I mean, that's pretty remarkable, 33,000 people. And I'm sure we have some failure rate, but for the most part, we are graduating folks who are doing amazing things. Our students are paying less money to come to Mason than they do to go to the average institution in Virginia. Our students are getting better jobs. Our students are getting better wages when they graduate. Some people say, well, maybe that's because where we are. Yes. So what? I mean, the fact is, we attract students from the state. We give them an education. We charge them less. They get better jobs. We have an incredibly, we identify ourselves as an innovative place. We're open to new ideas. We hold meetings like this, and we're curious. And people show up on a Saturday morning, afternoon now, to challenge themselves. There's an interest for how do we do our business? How do we do it better? I mean, so there are lots of things. I don't know how to capture those, but I hope that, Kim, you're in that task force of the visioning process, that we can capture those things that we do not want to change, those things we want to continue to be strong at, those things that we want to be absolutely protective of. We also need, and I think Sharon mentioned that, what is it that we wish? And I think that's the purpose of this whole process of crafting a new vision, is to answer that question. Is both a recognition of the things that we hold sacred, that we want to maintain about who we are, but also an explicit declaration of what is it we wish? How do we want to be even better? What are the kinds of things we want to be better at? And be very explicit about that. This is not a strategic plan in the sense that we're not trying to set up a very specific set of decisions that we know we're going to do this by this time and with this budget behind and so forth. This is a declaration of wishes. What is it we're trying to do? One of the things that President Ochoa mentioned, which it resonated, lots of things have resonated in my mind, but this in particular is that as we do that and as we engage in projects, it is also important that not only we have the wishes clear, but also we have some clarity around outcomes. To be honest with ourselves, to understand, are we coming close to those wishes that we established? Hey, if we find that the outcomes that we declared were the wrong ones, we can always change them. But at least we have to have a sense of what are the important outcomes that as a community we want to deliver on. And finally, top-down decision-making, or was it Soviet-style change management, doesn't have a terribly good record. I think, in fact, entrepreneurial innovation and change-making has a much better record of success. So, and that's something we know how to do when we have a good track record of doing at Mason, of empowering people to make decisions, of allowing, giving people a space. I mean, I've just been amazed by the number. I mean, some of the things we heard in the last day and a half, I knew a little bit about. Some of those, I'm like, oh my gosh, I had not even heard that we did this. So but it's amazing what's going on. So we need to do more of that, empower. But in doing that, we have to have that clarity about what it is we're wishing to achieve. Otherwise, we might be wasting resources, wasting time, trying to run experiments that really don't bring us closer. So I think that's the process that I envision, is how can we have that clarity around, first of all, who it is we are. I still get moved by the theme of freedom and learning that we have in our shield, and those core values that define us as a community, and the notions of innovation, the notion of inclusion and diversity, that I still is amazing that we hold that as a dear definition of what we are. Then clarity about our wishes, clarity about the outcomes that we want to deliver on, and then how can we create an environment where smart people can do cool things. So I think that's, in a nutshell, what I envision us doing. Some questions I saw earlier on the on Twitter space, and by the way, it's very difficult to be up here and not have access to Twitter. I don't know how the earlier panelists handled it. But it was, so now what? What is it we're going to do? So now, you know, do not expect the president is going to now come up here and give you a plan of what's going to happen. I think the outcome of this half a day was, the day and a half was the day and a half. The outcome of these conversations were the conversations themselves, was the fact that we as a community took this journey together of let's look at what's going on around the world and internally, and let's talk about it together as a community. It's not us going to conferences elsewhere and find out what's going on. It's let's go through this conversation together. And one of the things I heard earlier, I don't know if it was Sharon who mentioned it or Kim, I forgot, but the idea of, well, it would be nice if we could find a way of keeping this the conversations going. I don't know how to do it, but hopefully part of it is we now have videos of some of these events, and maybe they can serve as seeds for conversations that can take place elsewhere. Anyway, I'm really blown away by this. I've had so much fun. I'm ready to take a break. So I promised that I would keep this shorter than planned. But before that, I want to give an opportunity for comments, beginning with a little refresher of what's happening in Twitter space since we got disconnected.
Two key questions have popped up. Probably you can expect what they are. One of them is about these reward structures, and people are wondering about some concrete ideas for what those reward structures might look like, and not just for tenure stream faculty, but for term faculty and adjuncts as well. And the second question has to do with the breaking down of silos here at Mason, and I think Esperanza Roman Mendoza asked it best. Do we need a new task force on building bridges between GMU silos here?
I'd like to mention just the rewards piece, because small though they are, we have been able to reinvest about 80% of the money that probably will go away at some point for the DE fee in faculty scholarships or in software and hardware. This will probably cause more angst than anything else for me. But it has helped some people to at least come to the table. And then many of them, we have folks here today, have continued and created new courses and done many things with small amounts of money, so that's been useful. And the other thing is, we just launched a full program request for proposals. I think we have 8 of those currently, and we've identified the key things, like having an on-site director that could get halftime release for 2 years. We've kind of identified the four or five top things that we've heard from chairs and associate deans. We can't build full programs without these items. I don't know how we're going to pay for them, but we're going to.
I know that there are faculty experimenting with online courses and new methods of delivery, and I also know that many of them going into this experimentation have experiences of having their assessments from students dropping or having to go through the course approval process to make sure that they can teach this way in the future. So for me, questions come up about how the faculty are being assessed when they're teaching these classes, and which I think is a real concern. And then if someone's doing something really innovative and we're making progress, how do we ensure that these structures of approval are ones that forward innovation rather than stifle innovation?
And I guess I would just add to that. I mean, it's the money is nice. But the money is only going to take us so far. I rely, as you know, we're a small shop and we have close to 2,000 faculty, and there's three of us, and Bethany has a whole other full-time job.
But she's like three people.
Thank God. So I think that, you know, I think that we get to a point where it's not even about the money, because people run out of hours in the day. And when I was a faculty member, I remember this. It was like, I don't care how much you're offering. I don't have time to do this. There's not enough. I'm already working every week, and I'm already doing this. So I think that our annual review process needs to align with the RPT process, and the same things that are looked at there need to be looked at over here. Term faculty members, of whom we have many that we count on who are extraordinary, and many of them are Teaching Excellence Award winners and teachers of distinction, they go through the annual review process. So shifting the annual review process is something that still meets their needs. I think that when we start thinking about adjunct faculty, we need to have, in fact, Goodlett and I were chatting about this at coffee last week, is we don't know much across the institution about our adjunct faculty. I know I'm looking at Allison, who's nodding her head. Allison can probably tell me a lot about her adjunct faculty in the School of Management. And Ellen Rogers, who I think is also here, can probably tell me a lot about this adjunct faculty in the College of Education and Human Development. And Ann Baker can probably tell me a lot about the adjunct faculty in the School of Public Policy. But we don't know necessarily about our adjunct faculty across the institution. There's different kinds of adjunct faculty across departments. We've got people who are doing the sort of Beltway Bandit stuff. And then we've got also people who are professionals who've been teaching the same course for us for 8 years, every spring term, and they love doing it because they're sharing their knowledge with us. And those two groups of people have really different needs. And so I think one of the things that we really need to get a handle on is who are our adjunct faculty and what are their needs and what can we be doing. I think right now, the first time somebody teaches with us, the course evaluations come later. That probably also shouldn't be the only form of assessment that we're using to hire or rehire or make decisions about that for adjunct faculty. So what are the other strategies that we're going to use? But then also, you know, at some point, if somebody's been with us for 7 years or 5 years, is there an innovation, professional development, teaching component that comes part of that evaluation? I don't know the answer to that, but I think that we need to be thinking creatively about it, because we need to, A, open the door so they can join us in the innovative enterprise and not shut them out of that equation. And so I think there's that piece.
Let me ask that we get a number of questions from the audience, and then I'll give the panel an opportunity to respond to all or some of them. Mm-hmm. So who would want to start, please? And are there microphones circulating? Yeah.
Hello, thank you for a very thoughtful panel, and I appreciate bringing up the issue around faculty rewards. We're in a time, as I see it, where we're holding together both faculty needing to teach more students, an expectation of increased research productivity, and we're evaluated both internally and externally as faculty. So we can address some of the internal issues, and I think there are some great ideas. But how do we address the demands and the requirements that are happening via our disciplinary associations or our disciplinary affiliations? Because when we go up for PNT, I know that those external letters hold high weight in that process. So it's not just a matter of us communicating and changing what we're doing internally, but we have those external issues as well. So is there any ideas on how to do that?
Thank you. There's another one.
Same question in slightly different words. I'm at Mason for 30 years, and when I came here, teaching was the main thing. Then we slowly moved to research institution, made the Carnegie things on research institution. And at present time, you can't get tenure, at least not in College of Science, if you are not a researcher. So the question is really validity of the fact how we treat the younger faculty who is coming into the system and who doesn't have any time to really think about innovations because they have to do research. And how we build this with term faculty, whom we are telling only about the teaching, but they don't have a one-year job mostly, even if we keep them for 20 years. So somehow mechanism between research, teaching, tenure track faculty, term faculty, adjunct is slightly different, but term faculty, which is really a big strength of us, somehow rather some combination of that and some reward system for that, mm-hmm. and some salary for term faculty increases, is something which has to be discussed.
Thank you. Who else?
Well, you asked us in the beginning if we could set aside biases. And I'm an anthropologist by training, so I think I'm decent at that. Setting aside knowledge is a different thing. And so I actually have been struck by the ways in which, just as a whole, the university, as universes have been seen before as organisms and mechanisms, that we now see the universe as a business, as an economy, and the university is part of that. And so that was part of what I heard, which I already knew, but I heard it differently, I think, in the last couple of days. I'm not sure still what flip classes are. For me, that was just giving out the assignment and tell them to read it before they came to class. I don't know whether flipping means something other than that. I don't know what it means to be an unbundled faculty, hoping I can keep myself intact. Well, a lot of people here know me. I have trouble with that. So I'm wondering if one of the things that we might be able to do, because what I know as an anthropologist is that the oldest way that humans learn and the best way they keep it is storytelling. And every single person that spoke in this very conventional setting, except for tweets, told a story. They told a story about their own lives. They told a story about their experience. They talked about whom they met. Humans love that stuff. The brain eats it up. We haven't changed as a species. Technology is a capacity that we have, like language, but we tell a lot of different stories in different ways. So I'm wondering if we could continue this conversation, this is just an idea, by doing what I think flipping is, give us some reading first, and then invite us to a series of tables and let's have a conversation.
Thank you.
Please.
I'm Mark Pullen, professor of computer science, and I'm the coordinator of one of the oldest distance education programs on campus, the Master of Science in Computer Science. I only coordinate the distance part of it. We continue to grow slowly, but we could grow a whole lot faster if two impediments were not there. The first is that there's never been any institutional promotion, that is publicity, about the program. So it's really only known through its web page and word of mouth. The other is that the faculty teaching, and it's a healthy fraction of the departmental faculty, but the faculty teaching are all senior faculty, and I can't get new junior faculty engaged. And the reason for that is that they don't see it as supporting the incentive that's most important to them, and that's namely the path to tenure. In fact, they see it, if they teach online, they might get a poor evaluation, and so that adds to their risk. But there's absolutely no recognition of this kind of participation in, let's call it, institutional innovation, the program by the department. And as a result, they decline to get involved where they don't see that incentive.
Thank you. Last question, please.
This is not really a question, it's a comment. Since I've come in from the outside, I wanted to thank everybody for the wonderful program, really good speakers, really interesting conversations. And I especially want to comment and congratulate the fact that you've got this whole team of administrators here, upper administration. The fact that you've been here for 2 days speaks volumes to everybody here and everybody on campus. And that's an important message to send.
Thank you. We will not take any more comments after that right. One. So. Thank you so much. I owe you a beverage. So why don't you pick whichever of those questions? There are several related questions. Of course, a lot of interest in PNT rewards and so on. But why don't you do you want to start,
please.
Peter?
Okay. I hope that as we continue this conversation, and I like the idea of finding ways to continue to share stories, as we continue this conversation, we clearly need to talk about ways in which we can develop some additional funding, not only to reward individuals, but I would love to see an innovation fund not totally incomparable to what we're already doing with undergraduate research, where units can get rewarded for innovative approaches. We do not have that fund right now, but we need to work toward it, and I think that's a valid challenge. And that includes, by the way, figuring out better ways to identify adjuncts who can contribute to additional innovation and figure out how to reward them as well. I don't want to be glib about this. This is not something that exists, but I think it's a valid goal, and we will pay attention to it. 2 points were raised where I think we can be a little more concrete already. One is, I think it's very clear. Lots of units depend strongly already on term faculty who contribute really important teaching strength, and not just in the classroom, but in terms of thinking about teaching. I know different units at the university vary here, but I will say categorically that as provost, I think we need to embrace term faculty as an integral part of our overall faculty. Some units do this quite well already, but some need to do it a lot better. This is going to be a strength on which we depend to deal with this aspect of our mission. I also realize that different units vary with regard to the extent to which they credit faculty teaching for P&T. The faculty handbook very clearly states that faculty can come up for promotion and tenure on the basis of a primary emphasis on teaching excellence. That's in the handbook. We need to utilize this option more rigorously and systematically than we currently do. It's not a fundamental innovation. But I will say that as you look at our responsibilities as a university, I want us to grow as a research university. I think we can continue to grow as a research university. But our first obligation is to the educational process and the learning outcomes of our students. And frankly, our primary budget base rests on dealing successfully with our students. So teaching has to loom larger than it currently does in some unit reward structures. We have the framework to do it. We need to put some teeth into it, and I will fully support that degree of change within a framework that is already, I think, fundamentally adequate.
Thank you. Janet?
I think it would also be helpful if we can begin to shift the value structures with department chairs, P&T committees, deans, and so forth about what really does matter. And so we can look at the research teaching issues, but what about, how did those get integrated? So people are doing research, and we can value that, say, in the College of Science, but what about those people doing research, able to integrate their students into that through the Students as Scholars program, really taking the initiatives to engage students directly in how they build their research, how they develop new knowledge, so that it really is more of a seamless sense of things as far as how we look at the research and teaching aspects. They're not dichotomies. Often they are very much integrated. To value the kind of work people do, whether it's working with students in that capacity, helping to construct experiential learning kinds of experiences that take a huge amount of time and effort, thinking of that as a way of teaching and not just a way to get out of the classroom and, you know, spend more time out in the wilderness, there's real good, deep value in doing that kind of work. So helping to change the culture a little bit, and also that culture, to respond to Jamie's issue about that external validation, how can we better prepare those who write the letters to think about research and teaching differently? So granted, they may have to speak to the research issue, but wouldn't it be interesting if they could also be asked to talk about what do you see as far as how this professor is really trying to engage his or her students in this process as well? Asking different kinds of questions and then making it matter when it comes back to campus. I also wanted to just respond to the Twitter issue about the silos. It's interesting, I've been here 25 years, and it's so interesting how we seem to reinvent the wheel constantly. That part of our mission has been to try things, to be innovative. And the challenge is when a group wants to try something they think is innovative that another group has been doing for quite some time. We have to have these conversations with one another to understand that there are best practices. There are good ways of doing things that we can learn from our colleagues about. Having faculty, staff, learning communities around various issues is one way we can do some of that that might help to break down those silos. Looking at real programs or problems that we're going to look at. So MapWorks is an interesting one now where many people are engaged in trying to make the learning meaningful for students and to understand how to help them be successful. I think there are a number of ways that we can continue to work together, but we have to value each other. We have to say we can learn deeply from one another as well.
I just want to say that 21% of public institutions have a separate marketing budget for distance ed from their office. You know, that's not something we've looked at. Marketing is obviously a big deal. I also want to acknowledge the fact that we have some private companies here who've stayed for 2 days. They've contributed $10,000 to this conversation, and it's been mostly our own faculty who have been here. So there's not tremendous gain in terms of their being here and participating. This is a shift in the marketplace that I'm familiar with, and there are privates who are very, very willing to look at creative partnerships. ASU mentioned at least five, some of them I hadn't heard of before. So I wouldn't discount that as a possibility for some portion of where we go in the future. The big thing is, to me, is the institutional barriers as well as kind of the challenges that the privates have trying to deal with, you know, with the public kind of issues and personality that are very different in private institutions, private colleges. So that's just one thought.
Sharon and Kim, do you have any closing thoughts or reactions?
Yes. All of you have pens at your table. You've been diligently taking notes from our Students as Scholars Initiative, which is being directed by Dr. Bethany Usher, who's also Associate Director of the Center for Teaching and Faculty Excellence. Two things that are happening that I think are directly related to what we're trying to do as part of this conversation and what we're trying to do in terms of educational reform and innovation on campus. We are trying to not only increase the opportunities for undergraduate students to work with faculty mentors in one-on-one relationships, and many of you have participated in that, but we are also trying to, at the departmental level, encourage academic units to build scholarly inquiry and discovery and research and scholarship intensive experiences into the curriculum. And there's tons and tons of information on our OSCAR website, which is on your pen, and I encourage you to take a look at that. We're in our now second year of that initiative, and the inquiry pieces and the research and scholarship intensive classes, that's all about doing the kind of stuff that Ken Bain talked about in his keynote address about asking deep questions that lead to more questions that lead to more questions as part of a central pedagogy. So I want to do a plug for that. The other plug is it got mentioned on the Twitter feed. There are currently two requests for proposals that are collaborations between the Center for Teaching and Faculty Excellence, the Division of Instructional Technology, and Campus Facilities and Planning that are about designing learning spaces. One is a proposal that we're asking faculty or faculty teams or faculty and student teams to think about what it is that they would want to see in their ideal learning space, what are the outcomes that they'd want to achieve, and a couple of selected proposals will work with our architects and work with our instructional designers and work with folks in our office to be able to create learning spaces that we can play in and see whether or not they're being effective. So that's one. The other is Bob Buechner's model that he pioneered, which is now, as he's mentioned, in many campuses across the country, is in fact a room that's being built in our new Science and Technology 2 building. And that will be going online, we hope, in the summer, but certainly by fall of 2013. That particular room is built in that same model that you saw him show in his presentation. And we're soliciting interest from faculty who are interested in teaching in that space so that we can start in the spring having the conversation about what it would mean, and Susan, this goes to your point, to flip your classroom in such a way so that you don't enter that space. I mean, talk about jarring what to do in a space. As a faculty member gets into that space and the podium's in the center and there's all these circle tables around them, that's really disruptive if you're not expecting it. And you have to plan for it and be intentional about those activities and assignments. So there's another RFP for that. We extended, because we hoped this conversation would lead to potential interest in those, we extended that deadline till Wednesday, this coming Wednesday, November 7th. They're fairly brief proposals. They're not long, but I encourage you to take a look at the CTFE website, which is on your pad, and the OSCR website for those kinds of curricular innovations that we're working on right now.
Thank you.
And I just wanted to build briefly on the flipped classroom comment, because it sort of pointed out to me sort of the silo issue, the importance of talking about the good activities that are happening at the institution. And also possibly some of you may have been exposed to terms that you had never heard before, and perhaps we need to do a better job of explaining of what's going on in the technology context, how people are adopting and using these kinds of tools, and that's work that we can possibly do together. I learned something because I don't think I was even aware that there are the many different types of MOOCs, which is why I religiously try to find a time to talk with Brian Alexander from time to time, because he seems to always know, you know, the next thing. But we have to figure out ways of ensuring that we're talking about this across the campus more adequately than we are now.
Any closing thoughts, Peter?
No, thank you.
Well, let me thank all of you. This has been just absolutely terrific. Everybody who's participated in planning this, again, some of them are here with me. Several of them are sitting in the room. Thank you all. Yes. I just want to, one person I want to point out, the gentleman next to me, we had a conversation about doing this before I arrived, and that was my first exposure to the Peter Stearns decision-making speed and style. He said, I think it's a good idea, consider it done. And the next thing I knew, there was a date, there was a room, and there was a program. I was like, see if you like the program that we put together. So, Peter, I really appreciate your leadership on this. Thank you so much. Thank you all.